looks like it's working.
Don't worry, I'm going to be learning about Salam Shkin eventually, next week.
Well, then, the Chalik.
Ah, so what did we have yesterday? So yesterday we said that the exile is a state, every exile is a state of a dream, is a dream state. And the plus of it, meaning the positive side, is that in dreams, the inner aspect of understanding disappears. And what takes over is the small-mindedness. And small-mindedness is not afraid or is less critical of what it sees. And so therefore, you can put two things together that don't belong together. And that is called igulim, interestingly enough. Right? We said this yesterday.
Right.
That's igulim. Igulim, the circular aspect. Arizal says that Hashem created the world with two aspects. Circular and straight.
And linear.
And the circular has no top or bottom, so that's why two things that are opposite can be together, because they don't really have to, you can't really tell which one is above and which one is below, so they fit together. And another way of saying it is that the eye sees a circle, but the brain processes linearly, except for when you're asleep. And then it gives up on the linear processing, and it doesn't have to analyze everything that way, and so things can come as they are. And you can see things that are not connected as being shayach to one another. Suddenly they're fine together. So the main example of that is that a person both davens and he works after his livelihood. We said for most people it's the other way around, that he takes care of his livelihood, and he sets apart some time to daven and to learn.
I should have a famous story. A Jew was asked why he was successful in business, and all the Jews are so successful in business. So we've got 3 times today where we stop and quiet and think about all the things we've done so far today.
It's unbelievable. Most people don't realize this, that it's uncommon to have people stop in the middle of the day and to actually process.
It's unheard of. It's only Jews.
No, so now the whole world's into it, because guided imagery and everything that does, we talked about a little bit yesterday. Not us, afterwards I had another class.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought about it, mindfulness is a way of getting into igulim. Mindfulness is an attempt to see things for what they are, face value,
mm-hmm.
without trying to analyze them.
Evaluate the truth?
No, it's not to evaluate. It's not critical thinking at all. It's just a state of accepting things as they are. That's what davening really is. Davening is really, in a certain sense, it's stopping the analytical thought in order to connect with Hashem as I am, as is. I don't criticize myself during davening.
Yeah. Why?
Afterwards. After you finish, then yeah, you can do some criticism. Soul searching. So what do we say? That this is, he said this is the same thing as Hashem's name during the exile not being read as it's written. Okay. So all this, just read the last sentence again. Rak shenimshach derech kavim, right, in the second paragraph. Mm-hmm. Then the second paragraph. Azay yesh itchalkut kav yamin v'chesed v'chulu. Only through the straight the descent of the Sefirot in a straight line, in a linear line, do we have a separation between left, right, and center? Meaning, do we have categorization or taxonomy of reality? But when the Sefirot are in the state of Igulim, when they're in the state of being circular, there is no such differentiation. They're not categorized. And that's a very important thing. It's like it's like two ways of approaching reality. The Sefirot are just a shorthand for saying this is how Hashem, this is the structure that Hashem uses in order to create reality. Or these are the emanations, as they call it, or the conduits through which God creates reality. So in the state of linear, when there are three lines, so there you have categorization, meaning you look at reality that God created and you analyze it. And you say, this belongs here and this belongs there. This was in the past, this is in the present, this is in the future. By the way, the three lines are obviously also past, present, and future. How does it work? But the past, which one's the past? The right side. The left side is the future, and the middle axis is the present. So even just the fact that you have three lines, three linear lines of Sefirot, is saying that I categorize things in past, present, and future. But in Igulim, but in the circular system, everything is the same. It doesn't matter if it's past, present, and future. Everything can live together. And that's the dream state. There's no divisions there. There's no such thing as separateness there. In Igulim, there's no sense, in the circular reality, there's no sense of anything being separate. And you don't see any separation between the different entities. Everything is one. By the way, the head of the Israeli, the former head of the Israeli space program is apparently mad. Literally, he needs help. Yeah. I don't know how old he is. Probably in his 80s.
He's an Alzheimer's.
Well, maybe. Oh, you would know. Mm. So he's decided to come out with a big revelation. Mm. There are aliens.
Oh, yeah.
You heard about that? It's a very sad story. But you can learn something from anything. Even from, I guess, Alzheimer's. You have to ask him, what spaceships do they come in? Are they round or are they long, like a cigar? You'll see that in the UFO culture, there's two types. They're either round or cigar-like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, those are the two pictures that people imagine in their heads that they see. Why the round? The round, it represents that everything is one. Really, that's where they're trying to get the Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad. They're trying to get to some kind of consciousness of everything being one. So I would assume that most of the, if I would do a test, a psychological test on people who think that they've seen a UFO. So what did you see? Something round or something long? So I would assume that most of the people who saw something round would imagine that the aliens are here to create unity. Great oneness. But if you imagine them as being long, the ships, so these are people who think that the aliens are very different, very separate, and they've come to make war. That is the first thing I would test, like to check them. How does your imagination work? Because if you imagine something as round, so you're imagining some kind of oneness, some kind of unity. If you imagine things as being narrow and long, linear, so you're imagining something that's much more of a threat, something that would cause separation. It wouldn't be here for peaceful purposes, as it were. Anyway, this figures into all of culture.
See, we never explained there can't be such a thing as aliens in outer space, because it says in the Kodesh, Bereshis Bara Elokim Hashemayim V'Eretz Ha'aretz, and they put the man on the ground. Because he put it on the ground. The ground means this earth here. The only people in outer space that there could be would have to be people who came from here and went there.
If it's people.
For Muslims. Whatever it is, Hashem only wants life on this planet.
Rebbe never said that. Rebbe never said that, said the opposite. Read the Shalom Uvracha, Professor Green. You seen that book? You know Velvo Green.
Yeah, I know.
You know what he did in his life.
What?
He was head of...
I know personally.
Okay, so you know what he did in his life, for NASA.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he had a lot of conversations with the Rebbe about this, and he wrote to him about it, and the Rebbe wrote back very clear things.
What did he
write? One of the things he wrote is that it's not an issue. First of all, Chazal mentioned that there could be alien life. There's a pasuk in Shoftim, in Shirat Vora, that indicates that there is life elsewhere. Okay, whatever, it's a pasuk, yeah, it's a nevuah, it's a song, who knows, it could be, you know, all allegorical, you don't know. There's no contradiction to anything in Torah. The only question that's interesting is, do they have any new pshat in Chumash? That's the question. The fact that it can be life, it can be life. Why is life only here? No, anything on the contrary. It was mamish open-minded. But, apparently there's none. Because it hasn't happened yet. And so there's all these theories why they wouldn't, why we're the idiots who are broadcasting that we're here, and nobody else is broadcasting. It's called the dark forest theory. And you're in the dark forest, what's your best strategy for getting out alive? So the best strategy is to stay quiet. Because you see that's what animals do. The animals that, you know, are in the air, they don't mind so much. So they make noises. The ones that are on the ground are very, very quiet. Because you don't know if what you're going to meet is going to help you or eat you. So the best strategy is always to stay quiet. So the people of the dark forest theory or strategy have been trying to convince all of the nations of the world to stop broadcasting the signals into space, advertising that we're here. Because who knows who's going to come calling? Somebody that might eat you. You don't know. Anyway, but still the notion that whatever you think of, the shape of the things that you think of, they represent what type of thinking you have. Whether it's like igulim, circular, where everything is one, there's no separation, or whether it's linear, where there is separation. For the igulim to appear, what is igulim? Igulim is like sovev. That's what we call the surrounding light. It's not exactly the same thing. There is a difference between the two. And the Alter Rebbe switches. This is one of the main things I want to talk about. That from 1802 and on, he switches slowly from talking about Igulim and Yosher to talking about Sovev and Memale. They're not completely synonymous. And we have to understand what the difference is between saying circular and linear, and saying surrounding light and filling light. Although they have the same impact, that surrounding light and circular, the circular structure of the Sefirot, they both are talking about a not changing reality, a reality that's not changing. It's almost static. While the light that fills all worlds, and the linear picture of the Sefirot, that's about change. They're discussing change. So we'll need to see more of this when we get into 1802, hopefully tomorrow. אך ליאור בחינה זו בגילוי למטה אינה קיימה לידי בחינת שינה והסתלקות המוחים בגלות. ועל זה נאמר על פי שמיים כדרות. So the only time that a person in his waking, in his life, in this time of exile, can come to understanding of the igulim, of the circular structure, is when he's asleep. Because when you're asleep, the mochin, the mind, is gone. It's in Golus. It's in exile. And this is what the verse calls, I will garb the heavens with darkness. Shamayim hem chinat igulim. So the earth, the heavens represent that which is unchanging, right? The whole point of the heavens is that it's not changing, as opposed to on the earth where things change. So the heavens always in Torah is a symbol for that which is not changing. So that's igulim. Hem elubashim b'chinat kadrut v'choshech. They're hidden, usually. Shu'elem v'ester. She'az me'iru mitnotetz milemala mo'olam ha'elyon shu b'chinat igulim b'chinat cholom. Shu kuach hamdame lechaber shnei hafachim b'noseh echad kilo mechadim ha'ma. So normally we can't see the heavens, in this case the igulim. When do we see them? When they suddenly shine down on us. Suddenly there's like, the Rambam describes this in the introduction to the Guide to the Perplexed, like a person walking in the darkness, in a dark night, with no moon, and then suddenly there's a bolt of lightning. So that bolt of lightning is a revelation. So it's suddenly it's revealed. Suddenly what he see, where he is revealed. That's what a person has when he dreams. It's like a bolt of lightning that suddenly lights up the heavens. Really what it means is it lights up my circular understanding, that I can come suddenly to some higher ability to see that which is beyond change, the circular structure of this field. Yuchinat chalom, shukuach hamdame lechaber shnei hafachim b'nosei echad, ki'ilu hem echadim mamash. And then the result is that my power of imagination is there to witness it, and it has no problem seeing two opposite things at the same time. Because really, in the supernal world, meaning in the circular structure of the sefirot, they're all one. And there's no contradiction between them. Because there, everything is round, it's circular. Rak lemata, only here below, meaning in my waking state. Then do I begin to differentiate? Bitchalkut hakavin l'pi chokhma v'da'at, liot kav zekach v'zekach, azay nireh v'nigla ha'yipuch. Then it seems that things that are contradictory cannot combine anymore. Which is right? It depends. Hashem wants both. He wants you to also to be able to appreciate the igulin, to be able to appreciate what it means to paint a canvas that has everything on it, and it's all present at the same time, and it makes sense. And he wants you also to live in the world of linear transformation, where there is change.
So what about the Shilas Kodim? What about people?
Right, that's very interesting. So what are you doing there? You're tapping into the world of Yigdim. When you're asking a question before you go to sleep, it's actually a legitimate way of even paskening, of even ruling in halacha, when everything else has been exhausted and you can't figure out linearly what the right answer is. So you go back to the world of Igulim, and you do that in a dream. There's this famous thing from Reb Nachman, that Egel HaZahav equals Koach HaMdameh. We mentioned something like that, something close to it. We said that Zilpa, who is Yaakov's wife, the maidservant of Leah, she's also equal to Koach HaMedame, the power of imagination. So we have the Egel HaZahav, the golden calf. Why? Because they had exhausted all their options as far as they could tell. Meaning, in their world, Moshe Rabbeinu was gone. Moshe Rabbeinu was the linear. He was the one who was answering questions based on change. And he was gone, so what do? So you have to go back to something else. Circular reasoning. Again, it's not reasoning, but it's seeing the whole picture, and there's no contradictions. You don't solve things in Igulim by going through the logic that the Gemara goes through. It won't work, because there's no logic there, the same way that we understand logic. Why are we saying this? Because Egel literally means a calf, but it's called an Egel. Egel is from the word Igul. It's from the word round, same word as Igulim. And Zilpa, she's the maidservant of Leah. Leah is the world of understanding. And her maidservant is the power of imagination, which is the servant of understanding. To say it another way, we said this, I think, on Monday, that what is usually missing in technology is imagination. And imagination puts the opposites together. So, for instance, for Orville and Wilbur Wright to fly a plane, they had to put two things together that didn't make any sense. Right? An engine and a contraption that's supposed to, I don't know, somehow glide. But the engine's heavy. How are you going to get it off the ground? It's very heavy. And the contraption is not so strong. And then their imagination was so strong that even though they only flew for, 11 seconds or something like that, it was very quick until the whole world changed because of that chap, that you can put those two things together. And so much of changing things is putting things that don't belong together. So they even have a way of saying it in Hollywood. It's called this meets that. It's like what's surprising is you take, I don't know, Gone with the Wind meets Star Wars. I don't know. Whatever that is. Maybe that's what Star Wars is. I don't know. And it's this meets that. They don't belong together, but I'm going to put them together now. And putting them together is surprising. And suddenly, where did that come from? It came from Igulim. It's a different type of thinking.
It's cool marriage.
It's like a marriage also. The man is the Yoshir. He's the straightness. And the woman is the Igulim itself. And to bring them together, you have to have a higher form of Igulim. So that's why, I guess, wedding ring is circular. And there's no question of how it should be. So really it should be square on the inside and circular on the outside. Okay. But you can't wear that. So in practice people flip it.
Where did you get that from?
That's what it says in Kabbalah. That's very easy. But since that doesn't work, then then you have to do it the other way around. Circular on the inside and square on the outside. But that represents the man and the woman. Okay. So in linear, there are two opposites. And then they're separate and distant from one another. So for this reason, we can't reveal true unification or inter-inclusion in wisdom, which is the beginning. Even though wisdom is nullification, it's many good things. But it also happens to be the beginning after the crown. The crown is round. But chokhmah, wisdom is already straightness. It's already linear thinking. And it's where the three axes begin to appear. Because the first sphere that has a location on an axis is really the chokhmah on the right axis. Keter is not on any of the axes, in a certain sense. It's not on the middle axis. Even though we do put it there. We put it there. But really, the Keter itself is built out of three parts. And three parts, each one is something else. So you can't really say about the crown that it's right, left, or center. אלא בבחינת שינה והסתלגות המוחים וגלות הזיים מתנוצץ ומאיר האור העליון והוא מסתתר ומתעלם בבחינת כדרות וחושר דיין בבחינת התלבשות האלם. לא בחינת גילוי, כי גילוי בחינת חוכמה ודעת שהוא על פי קווים. So, you can only get this when you're sleeping. And when the mindfulness, the regular large-mindedness of this world, working in this world, I wanted to mention something before, the reason that we sleep less than we're awake is because the main task that we have in this life, in this world, is linear. It's not that you can pass life by just thinking about how everything is one, it's fine and dandy. It doesn't work that way. Because Hashem demands, He wants work. You want work. You won't feel content if you just sit and daydream all day long. You understand that at some point, you have to start doing. You have to start moving. And the ratio is at least two-thirds to a third. Two-thirds of the time you're awake and one-third of the time you're asleep. That's the minimum. really, some people take it much higher. 20 hours they're awake and 4 hours they're asleep. A lot of people, most of the people I think in the world, are somewhere in the middle. That there are 18 hours of wakefulness and 6 hours of sleep. But that just means that in this, meaning 3/4 to 1/4, but that just means that in this world, the goal is work, is being in a linear state, in a state of following change, and causing change. I was waiting in the long line at the post office yesterday, even though I ordered a toll.
Reserved a spot.
I reserved a spot in the line. So I was looking at people, and I said, it's hard not to see people, but every person is really an agent of change. That's what Hashem wants from every person. You're supposed to cause change. What are you going to change? So I saw the women there. She has a family. People have children. That's a tremendous change in the world. Sometimes that's all they do, and it's a huge deal. Because if you're not an agent of change, then life is sort of passing you by. You're not really doing anything. And that's really what the Rebbe wanted from every person. That you should be an agent of a good change. V'la'atid lavo, but in the future, Ketiv, it says, lo yikanef od morecha, he keeps saying everywhere. In the future, the sovev, the igulim, will be revealed. B'kanaf v'levush, v'lachen v'yomu yash, meaning, what's hiding them now? Two things. Your wings and your garments. These are two symbols in Kabbalah and Chassidus for change. For change. For linear type of thinking. Hitlabshut is like memale. For something to be engarbed is like for me to change, be changed by what I understand. So by filling light that fills all worlds, that's another way of saying something was engarbed in me, imbued in me, and I wear it, as it were, or I become its garment, meaning that it's changed me. That's the main thing in Levush. Levush means it went through a change. And Kanaf, and the wing of a bird, is really its agent of change. It's with the bird that you move from, with the wings that the bird moves from place to place, and in a person, the kanaf is not just something that covers the bird, and therefore it's like a garment for you, but it's also how you flap, and you use the flaps to move from place to place to cause change. ולכן ביומו יש שמו אחד שלא יהיה מלובש ומחוסה בנרתיק ויהיה נקרא כמו שנכתב. And therefore, when he's taken out of his garment, Hashem's name will be read the way that it's written, because the garment will be no different than what's inside it. So in this case, the way that the name is read, which is the garment, will be the same as what's inside, which is the name as it's written. Ki ayin ba'ayin yirun. This is called seeing eye to eye. We mentioned before that the eye is circular. There's a statement that Reb Nachman develops, and I've also seen it in the Alter Rebbe somewhere, that Natan bo inav afachol gal atzamot. Rebbe Yehuda, it says once in the Talmud that there was somebody who was trying to hurt him, some heretic, and he put his eyes on him and he transformed him into
a pile of bones.
So they say, far be it from, we said that before, that as you grow older and you mature, everything is with compassion. So he certainly wouldn't turn him into a pile of bones. So it's explained that it's an image. It's a metaphor. What for? That he put his eyes on him, says Reb Nachman, again, I've seen this in Chabad also, that it means that he took him up to the level of the eyes. What do the eyes see? They see circular reality. What circular reality? Everything is one. Meaning he took away his free will. Because free will is when you're separate. You can only have free will if you're separate from everybody else. Otherwise, it's not free. You can only have free will if you're separate from God. Otherwise, you're not free. You're just doing what God wants you to. So natan bo enav ve'asa mimeno gal shel atzamot. He made him into a pile. Gal is also a pile, not just again a pile. Okay, it's also a wave, but same idea. It's circular. Igul comes from the same word. Of atzamot, it's read atzmut. He made him into a pile of atzmus, meaning he took him back to where everything is one. And where everything is one, you can't hurt me. It's like I take away, you're just another part of Hashem. So there's nothing that I have to fear. There's nothing you can do to me. That's why in the future it will say, when Hashem redeems us, then we will feel that we were dreaming. Meaning, so now this is the final switch, that Hayinu can go on two things. We said it's either we were in the exile in the state of dreaming, or we are now that we're in redemption in the state of dreaming. So what will it mean? It means that we will see then, when the redemption comes, that during the entire exile we were in a state of dreaming. Meaning we understand now we understand Ainu. We understand now that we were dreaming. Until now we didn't understand that the whole exile was just a dream. The whole purpose of the exile is to bring opposites together. And that's the whole Chap of Chassidus. The whole point is that you can connect to opposites. Or in this case, the opposites we started with on Sunday are change and no change. Igulim and Yosha. ובחינה זו של החלום, עד אשר כולם יכירו וידעו וישיגו החיות הנמשך להם בזמן הגלות שהוא מבחינת החלום. And what they will understand is that the whole exile, we were in a state of dreaming, meaning that we were receiving our energy from Hashem in a state of carrying opposites, of two things being together, even though they don't belong together. Meaning there will be clarity. It's like you'll wake up. So we once mentioned this from the Ramad of Voli, of Moshe David of Voli. Somebody sent me pictures of his grave in Padua. So if you want to go after we take a trip to England, if you want to go to Italy, just to visit him. His yahrzeit is on my anniversary, Zion Tavis. I just realized that again this year. I realize it every year, but I forget. So he writes in one of his books something very interesting. He says, everything since Adam went to sleep has been a dream.
Mm-hmm.
Because it says that Hashem v'yapel Hashem Elokim tardema ala Adam. But where does it say that he woke up?
Maybe it's obvious, maybe it's a given.
Yeah, but it doesn't say it. So if it doesn't say it, you can nitpick. The Torah didn't say that he woke up, he must still be asleep. So this is just all of Adam's dream. Because the whole reality that we have here is what? It's igulim, because here you have the male and the female together.
And so we're part of his dream.
But don't think that you don't exist, he says. Because we will wake up, and then we'll see that this was a temporary state. כולם יכירו וידעו וישיגו החיות הנמשך להם בזמן הגלות. They will understand where their life came from during the time of the redemption. It's all a dream. ולכן יאמרו, היינו כחומים. That's why they'll say, we were dreaming. ובזה יובן מעלת ומדרגת יעקב ויוסף על ידי החלומות. Now we can understand what Yaakov and Yosef achieved through their dreams. ויש בחינה שיוסף הוא יותר במעלה ממדרגת משה רבנו עליו השלום. And because of this, because Moshe represents the linear state, and Yosef and Yaakov represent the circular state. So there's a certain aspect in which Yosef is higher than Moshe. That as much as Moshe Rabbeinu understood the linear picture of change in the divine, Yosef understands the circular picture. And there's a question here. Why is this? Because we never hear that Moshe dreams. The only dreams in the Torah are here, in the month of Kislev. whose sense, we didn't mention this until now. Why is he talking about this now? Because in the month of Kislev, according to the Book of Formation, the sense is the sense of sleeping, which really is the sense of dreaming. So Kislev is a time to consider the fact that this is all a dream. We're meant to reveal, to uncover the opposites. This is what, as I said, that, you know, we've come to the apex of all of this. The apex is Hollywood, without a question. Where you can put, I said, the example that the Tzemach Tzedek brings of two opposites being together is that a person died and then he's alive. And in a movie, you can do that. But I have to understand how mind-boggling that would have been for the Alter Rebbe to see a movie. But he's describing exactly that. It would have been, yes, that's what I meant all along. All along I've been meaning that there's an ability to rewrite the script in such a way that doesn't make any sense.
But it was theater, which had much the same idea.
Ken, but it's still not a picture. You know that what you're seeing is a play. It's beautiful, maybe. Maybe it is. It has its own appeal. But when you see it as a movie, whoa. It's like, how did this happen? Until you understand how it works. V'nadav v'avihu hayu nefesh ruach shel Yosef. This is a very interesting addition at the end. That Nadav and Avihu are considered a Gilgul of Yosef. By the way, the moment you say Gilgul, what are you talking about? Linear or non-linear? Gilgul means reincarnation.
Mm-hmm.
What does the word literally mean?
Galgal.
It's a wheel. So the moment you say wheel, you understand how it's possible for a person to be alive, to die, and then to be alive again.
Okay, well,
that's a Gilgul.
Same as any other novel he's paying for.
Oh, but he's never he never passes away. He's something else.
No,
it's a higher level.
But it's also any other novel.
Can, but that's one of the sources of their being. Okay. But the idea is very clear. The moment you say it's a Gilgul, why do we use that word? It's a very interesting word to use. Gilgul, why would you be rolling? But the choice of the word, consciously or unconsciously, I don't know who chose it, is exactly the same idea here, that two things can be together even though they're opposites. And it's specifically the example that the Tzemach Tzedek gives in his rendition of this mimer, where he says that it's a person who has passed away and now is alive again. And Nadav and Vihu, they're Gilgulim, they are reincarnations of Yosef. And we know that they were, to a certain degree, higher than Moshe and Aaron. That's what mm-hmm. Aaron said to Moshe. They were greater than you and me. And it says, "V'anachum tmeim lenefesh Adam ze Avihu." So here we have to say that Avihu was the Nefesh, because he's referred to as Nefesh Adam, in the singular. So the Adam here is Avihu. And Nadav haya mibchinat ruach, and he was the spirit of Yosef. Because why? Because the nefesh is the igulim, and the ruach is the yosher, is the straightness. So Nadav was from the straightness. And there you don't need even hazah. V'alav ne'mar v'ruach nedivat ismecheini, v'zehu shkatuv noheg katzon Yosef, ki bizman ha'galut hanagat Yisraeli b'vchinat Yosef. So during the exile, we're all called Yosef. In a certain sense, all of Am Yisrael is now under Yosef. It's not under David. We're waiting for David to reassume leadership. And when David reassumes leadership, it becomes Yosef again. It's revealed that everything that we were in until now is Mashiach ben Yosef. It was all the redemption according to Yosef. And the redemption, according to Yosef, is to live with the goyim. It's to live everything together. Everything can be mixed up. But David, there becomes a certain taxonomy, a certain categorization. And that we'll have to think more about, what exactly that means. But in the Alter Rebbe, it's very clear what it means as for the individual. We'll end with this, that it means that everybody's life becomes very coherent. When the redemption hits, it becomes very clear to you what you were supposed to do.
And so therefore the Friedrich says that we'll all be hiding under the tables, wishing that the Golas would come back.
Good.
We didn't do what we were supposed to do.
Because we didn't get a chance. But you have to use the chance. That's the beauty of this world, is what Rashi said about it. In the Zohar, after Rashi passes away, in the Idra Zuta, just before he passes away, he says, the world that we are coming from, meaning this world from which we're going to Gan Eden, is a wedding. Damia lebei hilula. Alma de atimi mine lebei hilula damia. Why is it a wedding? Because in a wedding, everything is together. Everything.
Okay.
Everything is mixed up. So tomorrow, we'll see how he explained it in 1802. And Yosef is called Ben Porat Yosef, which means he's Poter. Tzafnat Paneach, he's the Poter Chalomot. He's the one who interprets the dreams, meaning he understands how to connect it all together. That's Yosef's big ability, to bring everything together. And that's the state of exile. So this, and on one level, it's very negative because it's exile. On the other hand, that's the greatness of it, that everything can be used together and come together.
Okay. Yeah. Get them over there, officer. Don't forget tomorrow's Thursday.